Listen to the word of God from Mark chapter 13. As Jesus came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what large stones and what large buildings." Then Jesus asked him, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." While Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will this be? And what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished?" Then Jesus began to say to them, "Beware that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is still to come. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. This is but the beginning of the birth pangs. As for yourselves, beware, for they will hand you over to councils, and you will be beaten in synagogues. And you will stand before governors and kings because of me as a testimony to them. And the good news must first be proclaimed to all nations. When they bring you to trial and hand you over, do not worry beforehand about what you are to say. But say whatever is given you at that time. For it is not you who speak, but the Holy Spirit. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When you see the desolating sacrilege set up where it ought not to be, then those in Judea must flee to the mountains. The one in the housetop must not go down or enter the house to take anything away. The one in the field must not turn back to get a coat. Woe to those who are pregnant and to those who are nursing infants in those days. Pray that it may not be in winter." This is the word of the Lord. You're kind of like quiet on that thanks be to God stuff right there, aren't you? Quite a passage. Let us pray. Almighty and gracious God, there are events in our lives that cause birth pangs and worries and fears. In the midst of all of that, help us trust you. For in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Every single generation has a defining moment. How many of you remember Woodstock? Okay, you weren't there if you remember Woodstock, you just weren't there. Do I have that many former hippies in this church raising their hands? Wars and rumors of wars, they mark every generation. World War II, members of the greatest generation continue to be recognized at events and gatherings. There are defining moments in every single generation. Korea, Vietnam, the 68th Democratic National Convention in Chicago, the Lovins, the hippies, 9/11, and many other events, they define generations. Each of those moments brings a bit of tension and worry to a wide swath of people. For many, the events help form a negative outlook on life. We tend to view the world more negatively than it really is. Every generation seems to think, this is it. The end of the world is upon us. There are wars, rumors of wars. Franklin P. Jones said in a recent edition of Psychology Today, "Nothing is more responsible for the good old days than a bad memory." Jesus gives us this end of times apocalyptic warning in this passage. You know, the disciples accompany Jesus to the temple. They see this gigantic place where people gather for worship, where sacrifices are made and offerings are made. And the disciples stand there in awe, looking at these large stones, these large buildings. And they say, "What huge stones!" they exclaim. And their response reminds me of the high school basketball team in Hoosiers who made it to the state championship. Gene Hackman playing Norman Dale in that movie as a coach. He takes time at this gigantic stadium where they'll be playing the state championship. He gets up on a ladder and he measures the height from the hoop to the floor. He goes, "It's the same size it is back home." The boys from Indiana are wide-eyed. Jesus' disciples from the backwaters of Galilee, they're also wide-eyed. "Big stones, huge buildings," they exclaim. It's comparable to traveling to Washington, D.C., a different world, a different architecture, a different view of life. Huge things that grab your attention there in the center, there at the tidal basin or on the mall. And whether it be the temple in Jerusalem or the seat of power in D.C., for someone to suggest that it will all be destroyed, well, they'd be perceived as crazy or cuckoo. And Peter, James, and John, and Andrew, they're so worried about what Jesus tells them that they pull him aside privately and ask him, "When will this be? What will be the signs?" And Jesus answers, not even answering the question, "Well, many will lead you astray. Many will, they'll bamboozle you. There'll be wars, rumors of wars, earthquakes, famines, and the end will come." Name me one day this past week when you haven't looked into the newspaper or online and haven't seen something about wars, rumors of wars, famines, and earthquakes. It's something that happens in every single generation. And then Jesus adds this little tagline at the end that says, "These are the beginnings of the birth pangs." Birth pangs. They're the indication of something new to be born into the world. And like the disciples, I'm not sure we quite get the gist or the point of what Jesus is saying in this passage. Like the disciples, we're thinking this world, this will end. An era will come to a conclusion. And yet Jesus is not speaking about the end. He's speaking about a new age, a new era, a new understanding of life, a new kingdom that is not of this world. The end of the world language Jesus uses, it always captures our imagination. It captures the imagination of each generation. I mean, how many of you remember the book by Hal Lindsey, The Late Great Planet Earth? That was back in the 70s. Or the Left Behind series, as well as other books with notable titles such as The End. I mean, you can't get any more final than that, The End. Will there be a sequel? I don't think so. It's The End. And so the passage begs the question, if you knew you only had X number of days before the end of the world, what would you do? In 1997, the Heaven's Gate cult donned Nike sneakers, and they awaited the Hale-Bopp comet. And 39 cult members committed suicide outside of San Diego, California. They thought this was the end. Jim Jones in 1978 led a mass murder-suicide of 918 commune members by drinking Kool-Aid-laced cyanide. They thought it was the end. Why do people follow such leaders? Why do they get ensnared in such a world construct, a world view that is there? Growing up, my end of the world scenario was, wait till your father gets home. That was my end of the world scenario. The other end of the world scenario was, hey, Brandt, you're wrestling tonight at 1:38. Oh, my gosh. If I could tell you the number of lights I saw on my back as a wrestler, it would dazzle you. Each generation sees an eroding quality of life or hope of the world. I'm not sure Jesus spoke of the world proper. The temple, the seat of power, the seat of worship, where God lived, represented the place of worship. It was a holy place. It was a symbol of power and authority. To even suggest that it would be torn down, well, that would be blasphemy. Jesus speaks about such destruction in the context of salvation. Now, there's a concept, salvation. In fact, this is Jesus' longest speech in Mark. It goes for 37 verses. It keeps going. It's shorter than most sermons, but still a long speech for our Lord. Don't measure me by the number of verses Jesus spoke in Mark. The destruction of symbols of power and authority, they cause crisis. Their falling shakes the very foundations of comfort, confidence, stability in the world. It's in moments of crisis that we ponder the future of the world and we consider how the world can be saved. Each generation wrestles with that. Big stones crumble during every single generation. It could be World War I, World War II, Korea, Vietnam, the assassination of political and religious leaders. When those things happen, we say, oh my God, what's going to happen to the world? Is this it? More recently, for later generations, it's 9/11, towers falling, the Pentagon being hit. You can think of your own examples of things that just define generations. These events share our sense of stability, shake our sense of stability, security, and hope in the world. Jesus tells the disciples a truth that none of us want to hear. Events happen in every generation that shake the foundations of our world, and we're not quite sure what to do with it. And every event is the beginning of a birth pang. Something new being born into the world of faith, an unveiling of how much we rely on God or should rely on God, a glimpse of an onion peel of salvation being peeled back just a bit more. And we do discover that salvation is a process of repentance, forgiveness, new birth, not a static event in our lives. It's not like you're forgiven, that's it. It's like there's a series of things that happens that we repent. We are saved, we're honed, we're shaped a little bit further. Just sit on a park bench on Fifth Avenue or in a booth at Perkins Restaurant here on Tamiami and listen to the conversations that people have. Every aging generation seems to say, kids today. Things just keep getting worse and worse. We keep going like this, there'll be no country left. We need to visit Lely Presbyterian Church. No, I'm just throwing that in there. That's what some people say. We make our declarations on the world and where it is going. Pearl Buck said, the young do not know enough to be prudent, and therefore they attempt the impossible and achieve it generation after generation. Listen to this one. The world is passing through troublesome times. The young people of today think of nothing but themselves. They have no reverence for parents or old age. They're impatient of all restraint. They talk as if they know everything. And what passes for wisdom with us is foolishness with them. As for the girls, they are forward, immodest, and unladylike in speech, behavior, and dress. A sermon preached by Peter the Hermit in 1274. And finally, this one. The children now love luxury, they have bad manners, contempt for authority, they show disrespect for elders, and love chatter in place of exercise. Children are now tyrants, not the servants of their households. They no longer rise when elders enter the room. They contradict their parents, chatter before company, gobble up dainties on the table, cross their legs, and tyrannize their teachers. Socrates. Every generation is worried about the generation that follows. We worry about the future, what the next generation will bring to the table of civilization. And Jesus tells the disciples, the end of an age is coming. The stones are going to come down. Something big, something central will no longer be there. A new one is on the horizon. And new things scare the living daylights out of us. Change is scary. It's frightening. We don't adjust well to endings in life. And by endings, I mean retirement, relationships, readjustments, and loss. We don't do well with change. A former parishioner who retired from a stressful job up north, he had no idea what to do with himself. Bill had difficulty adjusting to this new thing called retirement. He was in the central thing of a big company on the East Coast, and he's now in sleepy Lancaster County, Pennsylvania. The huge stones of executive leadership, they had tumbled in his life, and now it was all over. It's a new era in his world. And one morning, Bill had this great idea. His wife had gone shopping for the entire day. He wanted to help around the house. He wanted to surprise his wife with something special. And so Bill took the morning. He emptied the large pantry of all the canned and packaged goods. And being an engineer, he had this fantastic idea to restock the pantry with the foodstuffs he had removed. His wife returned home and with pride said, "Come here, dear. Let me show you what I did today. I think you'll love it." And taking her to the pantry, he opened the door, had rearranged every item in alphabetical order, complete with color-coded labels. He said, "You have to do something. You need to leave the house." Endings, beginnings, ages ending and new ones beginning, stones of stability knocked down without fully knowing what will replace them. They trouble us as they did the disciples. All the changes are the beginnings of birth pangs. We are called to grow and endure, to trust God when the chaotic waters of life rise and surround us, and they do. Our lives shatter when huge stones of stability in our lives fall apart. Birth pangs of change deliver us to engaging faith in a new way. Or should I say, faith engages us. God shapes us. God restores our soul, to quote Psalm 23. How many of us have asked in moments of disillusionment and hurt, why is this happening to me? What could I have possibly done to deserve this? What is God trying to tell me? Where is God in all of this? What in the world is going on? My God, why hast thou forsaken me? To quote Psalm 22. These are just a few of the questions we ask when treading water in the seas of insecurity and chaos, when our lungs fill up with the dust of large stones and huge buildings being destroyed. And to the disciples, the stones of the temple, they appeared immovable. There are rocks in our lives we think will always be there, but they won't always be there. For some, it's their parents or kids or job or that golfing partner, that friend, the predictable aspects of life. They come to an end and we don't know what to do. We think things are immovable, indestructible, indispensable, never expendable. Government, industry, faith, but sometimes those stones fall apart. They fall down and that thing that was stable is no longer there. And when one falls, we feel aftershocks, quakes through our souls, and that's when we turn to God in those moments of despair. Jesus commands his disciples to remain calm in the unsettling events to come. He seems to suggest that the approaching natural disasters and human-created catastrophes, they're necessary. Evil, we know it's rampant in the world. It affects the world itself, and it produces its own terror. But God's judgment and rescue are sure. I have to believe that. I do believe that. That's what I stand on. The end does not mean the end. The end means there will be a new beginning. Jesus' followers may trust the God that God is in control. We know that life gets really bad at times, and yet God is in control. It's easy to trust God when you have the world in the palm of your hand. But when you're not in control, then it's really a challenge to trust God. I was in Iraq, going through a divorce, not sure where I'd be working upon my return from deployment. I was not in control. I was a mess. We love to be in control. I love to be in control to decide the fate of our lives. But when we put our lives in God's hands, get ready for something new. Those stones have fallen. The dust is settling. And yet when the stones of stability fall, that's the challenge of trusting God. It's not easy. We learn through life that faith is not simply a concept to embrace. It grows. It changes over time. Faith is shaped by experiences both painful and pleasant, joyful and jolting, depressing and delightful. Faith engages the messy chapters of our lives, and faith in God becomes the stones of faith. That's the temple for daily living. Jesus' apocalyptic words shatter our understanding of stability of the day. The kingdom is not something that we can touch and feel. It's not large stones, but something more, something that is constructed by God, that is something in our hearts. Birth pangs are only the beginning. Events occur, and they force us to review who we are during endings and new beginnings. Let me close with this. Kathleen Norris, she's a Presbyterian minister. She's a writer. And she wrote about how she found her way through the fear of the end of times. She came to regard Christ's return as life-affirming in ways more subtle than any dictionary definition. And she writes, "What I mean is that this is an acquaintance of mine, a brilliant young scholar who was stricken with cancer. Over the course of several years, she came close to dying three times. And after extensive treatment, both radiation and chemotherapy, came a welcome remission. Her prognosis was uncertain at best, but she was again able to teach and to write. I never want to go back," she told her department head, "because now I know what each morning means. I'm so grateful to be just alive." When we come close to that end, before we have a new beginning, it changes our focus. It changes how we see things. It changes how we see our life. We don't go back to the normal old way of doing things. We do something brand new, a new era, a new life, a new way of looking at the world. Stones fall. Buildings crumble. The outlook of life and the understanding of God shifts. New eras begin. And unlike Woodstock, we remember them. Just as God remembers us. Today would be a great day to make a commitment or recommitment to Christ, who is always building our lives anew. Always. When the stones fall, the dust settles, and we are made anew. Thanks be to God. Amen.